In a world where success is measured in milliseconds, where decisions are made in the blink of an eye, how we embrace each day defines the temporal singularity for the rest of our lives.
Looking out at the Opera House and one of the most beautiful cities in the world. But this rate of change is happening much faster than it ever has happened before. I've been in the IT industry for 30 years, and the things that I've seen over the last 5 years have been mind-boggling. And the responsibility on us to be able to harness the power of IT and to be able to work out and not have to learn the mistakes that others have made to be able to progress becomes more and more important. And these events are about talking to people who've taken that journey towards the cloud, exploring the benefits of the hybrid, the public, the private, and how it is you build it together, because it's at the core of the innovation. And it's only one piece, but it's at the heart of how the transformation of IT is taking place. Now, today, we get an opportunity to talk to some of those people who've made those decisions, who've had to go and explain the concepts of what they're doing, and hopefully there'll be a great question and answer session. Now, firstly, I'd like to thank Lenovo and NetApp. Brilliant technology. Yes, I'm biased. Yes, we use it. Yes, it's brilliant because it allows us to deliver cheaper and better and faster. And that's highly important in this competitive world. So thank you to them. And I'd like now, but I'm going to give you an independent panelist who's going to ask the questions, because this isn't a selling exercise. This is a learning exercise. This is a question and answer exercise. So I'm going to hand over to you to Brad Howarth. Brad, I want you to know, left the Prime Minister's office today, early. He was supposed to leave there at 3:30, but he left there at 1:30. Now, I want you to know that he's left the Prime Minister's office to be with you. Now, if that doesn't make you feel good, yes, please, a round of applause. So, now, Brad is an IT analyst. He's written 3 books. He's also the former editor of the BRW Technology IT section. Please, a round of applause, and I'll hand over to Brad. Thank you.
Thank you. That introduction was mostly true, but then never let a fact get in the way of a good story. So thank you for that introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Interactive Bridge session for this evening. Yes, my name is Brad Howarth. I work as a journalist, author, analyst, and a bunch of other things. One day I'll actually figure out what I do for a living, and I'll be grateful because I'll be able to put just one thing on my business card. Thank you all for coming down tonight to this fantastic venue. Yes, we do have an amazing view there, but for the next half an hour or so, you have to look at me. I get to look at the view, as well as all of you beautiful people as well, so maybe I'm the lucky one right at the moment. So what is this all about? Well, for the last 20 years, seems like an awfully long period of time now, I've been writing or analysing the impact that technology has had on Australian business and society, and trying to get underneath the changes that are happening. Now, one of the big changes we've seen, certainly in the last decade, has been the emergence of cloud computing. and watching the way that cloud has gone from something which was a fairly esoteric concept. I remember back in the days of 2000 when we called it on demand, and then we called it as a service, and now we just call it cloud. But I'm sure at some stage later this evening, someone is going to say, how do you define cloud? 3 3/4 hours later, we'll have an answer to that. But we're seeing cloud have a significant impact on the Australian business community. It's gone from something which was simply a concept that maybe we dabbled into something which organisations are now rebuilding themselves around, or upon which new organisations are being built. And that's, I guess, what we're going to delve into tonight. So we've made cloud the focus for this particular event. We may in the future look at other areas. We thought this one is so disruptive right at the moment that it warrants our attention. Now, it won't just be me standing up on stage shouting at you about cloud. We've got a group of panelists up here that we're going to bring up. We'll be able to give you some coalface on the ground experience with regard to cloud and what it's meant for their own organisations, and I'll get to them in a moment. Now, as I said, I've been looking and writing about cloud for quite a while. I've been to, as all of you have, I'm sure, numerous cloud events. And you hear certain things at cloud events that sometimes I think need to be questioned. You know, sometimes we hear the fact that, oh yeah, cloud, it's just about tactical implementations. It's a good way of maybe getting a cost reduction on a particular function. Or it's being driven by the marketing function. These guys are running out and buying Salesforce, and we in IT aren't getting a look in. So I thought, why don't we maybe dig into that a little bit? Why don't we get underneath some of these findings and actually find out what's really happening out in the world? What is the reality of the situation of cloud for Australian businesses? So together with Interactive, we put together a survey, and we went out to market, and we interviewed 500 IT influencers, so people that are involved in making IT purchasing decisions at mid to large organisations across Australia. And we asked them, what do you think of cloud? What does it actually mean for your business? But I'm going to run through some of the results now because I think it frames up a lot of the discussion that we're going to move into in the second part of this. And the first question that we put out there was, we asked them about the maturity of adoption, what their roadmap to cloud was. And you can see the figures coming up on screen here. Were quite interesting. People talk about cloud as though it's ubiquitous, but it clearly isn't. We've still got some 60% of organisations that have not yet enacted a cloud strategy. We've got 40%, however, that have. Now, some ways of looking at that might tell you that that's low, some ways of looking at that might tell you that's high, depending on what your initial preconception was. What we found was really interesting, though, that of that whole group, of that 100%, only 15% have no plan of going to the cloud at all. So it's interesting, out of 100% of Australian organisations surveyed, only 15% have no plan of going to the cloud. What does that tell us? It tells us there's a lot of organisations that want to go to the cloud but haven't started yet. They're still in the strategic planning stage. And I think that's a good message for a lot of businesses out there that are still struggling to build up that business case, to get a good understanding of what the cloud will mean for them. Because it tells you that you're not too late. But I would advise you not to wait too long, because clearly we are seeing a lot of movement into the cloud. Interestingly, 14% of that total declared that their cloud strategy was now fully enacted, which is quite interesting. Now, we're not quite sure whether this is companies which are 100% cloud or have taken everything to the cloud that they plan to, but a lot of organisations have obviously moved quite quickly. Hopefully they're getting the results from that they want. So then we ask the question, who is actually making this happen? Who is the instigator of cloud in Australian organisations? And this, I thought, was a very interesting response, because we often hear about this notion of shadow IT, about how a line of business function like marketing or sales says, can't be bothered waiting for IT to do it any longer, you're too slow, you cost too much, you're too difficult to work with, we're just gonna go out and buy it ourselves. Well, it turns out from the group that we got back here, 80% respond to say that it's either the CIO or someone in the IT function which is driving their cloud strategy. CEO on the board, 10%, and then the other lines of business, another 10%. Now, of course, maybe these results are skewed a little bit, because we did happen to ask IT people for the answers here. So whether or not we actually have IT people taking credit for somebody else's work or not, I can't quite vouch for. But it was interesting. Certainly what we're getting back here is a definite trend towards the IT department wanting to take ownership of the cloud strategy. And I'm hearing that a lot in my work, of IT certainly wanting to wrestle back some of the implementations that maybe slipped under the radar thanks to a credit card about 5 or 6 years ago. So why are they doing it then? What is the business case behind this? We roll on. Now, this was an interesting one for me, because a lot of the cloud implementations that I've written about have been quite tactical. It's test and dev. Or it's taking a particular application like email and moving that out to the cloud because we can get a cost saving as a result of doing it. But our respondents, 78% of them claim that this is a transformative move. This is something they were doing to actually change their business. And I don't think you change your business simply by moving email into the cloud. You change your business by looking at the possibilities of cloud to do a whole number of things with regard to freeing up your infrastructure or creating other tangible benefits to the business that might appear over the long run. And I thought that was particularly interesting, that it shows a certain maturity of thought around cloud adoption. Maybe people are thinking about this more than just trying to get the quick win. And then if we go into the question then of what do they actually want to get out of it, what are the tangible benefits that these respondents wanted to get from the cloud, once again, an interesting finding here. A lot of the industry has been selling cloud on go to the cloud and you'll save money. I'm still waiting to find someone who can tell me that after a 3-year time horizon. But that's where a lot of the marketing has been, and that is certainly where a lot of the marketing was in the last decade. A lot of the industry seems to have wised up to this, that maybe it won't be as cheap over that period of time, so maybe cost shouldn't be the first reason why we go to the cloud. What is, as you can see, business flexibility. Now, whether that's the ability to spin up new environments quickly or whether that's the ability to get new applications into business quickly, and often if we dig into this a little bit further, you'll find that these sort of cloud adoptions also go along side things like the adoption of agile development methodologies and the introduction of DevOps into the organization. Those companies realize that having cloud gives you a whole lot of capabilities, but you also need the systems and processes to take advantage of that. Of course, cost saving is still second. Clearly, people don't want to go to the cloud if it's going to cost them more money, and a lot of them would like to see the cloud costing them less. The next one, though, moving away from CapEx, obviously, the financing model is something which is quite appealing to them there, this pay-as-you-go model. But I think a lot of organisations are also realising that pay-as-you-go doesn't always work out to be cheaper if you end up going a lot further than what you did previously. So it's an interesting nuancing of this in terms of the way that organisations are thinking about the benefits they're looking to get from cloud. So overall, what does this tell us? Clearly, most businesses want to go to the cloud. Apart from that 14% that don't, we've got 86% of Australian businesses that want to go to the cloud. I think this battle has been pretty much won now. Where the cloud takes over the whole organization or parts of the organization, it's going to be in just about every organization that's out there. The move to the cloud then being very much driven by the IT function, IT wanting to keep control. Obviously the IT function having to change its skill set now, maybe away from infrastructure management to vendor management, to having more of an understanding of cost models and the like, but certainly IT wanting to make sure that it doesn't get dealt out of the game by maintaining a degree of control and direction over that strategy. That they're going into the cloud to transform the business, perhaps because of this concept of digital disruption that we're probably sick of hearing about now. And I was going to say I'm going to try and get through this whole presentation without mentioning Uber, but I've just mentioned it, so I've broken that. But a lot of organisations are realising now that they need to have a more flexible technology infrastructure in order to be able to compete with the unknown unknowns that lurk out in the world today. Because they want to be more flexible. The final point, they want to be able to compete on an equal footing with some of these new organisations which are coming into the market at the moment. I spent a lot of my life in the startup world and I see young, hungry people in their 20s wanting to come through and steal market share from other organisations using innovative business models. And it's much easier to compete with a company like that when your own IT gives you the platform to be able to do so. So this leads us then, I guess, to the core thrust of what we want to be talking about in the panel session this evening. It comes into three themes. Firstly, that given that it's early days for many organisations when it comes to the cloud, where do you start? Do you stay small and tactical, or do you actually plan out the big picture transformation from the beginning and focus on getting that right before you take your first step? Secondly, if cloud strategy is being driven by IT, but it's actually being implemented to transform the business, how do you ensure total and complete alignment then between the business strategy and the IT strategy? Because I think in a lot of organisations for too long, there has been a line between them. What we see happening here is the need to blur or obliterate that line. And the third question then, there are clearly a lot of true believers in the IT function that have belief in cloud, the reasons we've just highlighted. What does it take then to build a business case? How do you bring the rest of the organisation along for the journey? How do you make sure that not only you as the true believer can actually get your team on board, but how can you get your peers on board? How can you get your other senior level managers on board with that same vision? But I can't tell you the answers to any of these. But I've got six other people that can. So I'm going to start to introduce them up on stage now. So our first speaker, or our first panelist for you this evening, is the Vice President for NetApp Australia and New Zealand. He is responsible for defining the strategy and direction of NetApp's local business and brings a wealth of experience to his role with 18 years in the IT industry in the UK and Australia. Round of applause, please, for Steve Manley, the Vice President for NetApp Australia. Our second speaker, or our second panelist, is the former CIO at Chandler McLeod Group, now the Managing Director of Symbiotic Consulting. He was instrumental in transitioning Chandler McLeod from a traditional IT model to a market-leading and fully integrated business group. Also served at Qantas, delivering IT operations across more than 60 countries, and was awarded the Australian Financial Review's new CIO of the Year in 2010. A round of applause for Phil Gray. Our next speaker is the Director of Cloud and Managed Services at Interactive. Over the past 5 years, responsible for leading Interactive's cloud and managed service, service quality, operational performance, and technology transformation. Prior to that, held senior positions at IBM, where he successfully managed and transformed multiple business units in highly complex, fast-paced global markets. I give you John Hanna. Our next panelist, responsible for delivering his company's IT strategies, implementing systems and infrastructure globally, he is Peter Waterman, Chief Information Officer at Flight Center. Something I didn't realize, but Flight Center has a network which now encompasses more than 2,000 leisure, corporate, and wholesale businesses across 11 countries. So a round of applause for Peter, who's managing that organization. Our next speaker for you, the Managing Director for Lenovo ANZ, Matt Codrington, responsible for Lenovo's business in the region across all government, commercial, consumer segments, and is also a non-executive board member of the Australian Information Industry Association and a member of the Australian Institute of Company Directors. By the way, if you haven't bought your tickets for the AAAAI Awards in Melbourne next Thursday, get a ticket now, they're still available. Come back to Australia's most livable city once more, as named for the fifth time in a row, only today. So congratulations again, Melbourne. And our final speaker, Theo Stevens, Chief Information Officer for Austbrokers, with more than 20 years experience in the general insurance industry, having joined Austbrokers in 2012 in the role of CIO after 10 years with QBE, where he was Head of E-commerce Development Global Distribution with responsibility for strategic IT development. So please, round of applause for Theo. So I'm just gonna stand here and sort of blend into the greenery a little bit and let you guys do the talking, but I might do some of that by prodding you a little bit with some questions, and then we'll go to the floor and see what they have to ask you. But Theo, I thought I might start with you. From a customer's perspective, it would be good to get a bit of an understanding about what your cloud journey has been and what's led you there. But there's probably a few people in the audience that don't really know what Austbrokers does. So if you can give us a bit of background on who you are, what you do, and then tell us a little bit about what's taking you into the cloud.
Okay, so thanks for that, Brad. Austbrokers is Australia's largest equity-based risk management group. We manage approximately $2.6 billion worth of insurance premium in the Australian market. We've grown to extend our capabilities into the New Zealand market this year. So we're quite keen to expand our capabilities across geographical boundaries. And some of the things that we had to consider over that period of time was what was our structure going to be for us to do that. And for us to expand that capability, the application of a cloud strategy was born. And from that point of view, we looked at a number of the key topics that are being raised by Brad in his earlier introduction, and that was flexibility to the business. How could we be flexible in a very competitive market, and how can we be flexible in an area where the business needed to be able to adjust with changing market conditions? So having that style of a platform provided us the capability to be competitive in a market that's very, very aggressive as well. We're in the last bastion for insurance. It's very traditional in its market presence. And to be competitive in this market, you need to consider technological changes and advancements that allow you to be more creative, more innovative, and more agile than your competition.
Phil, you had quite a lot to do with the setting up of the cloud strategy for Chandler McLeod. So maybe take us through a little bit of the work that you did there.
I was interested in your graph up there as to what the drivers are. So if you look at cost, agility, speed, you speak to the CEO, what does the CEO want? They want results. They kind of don't care about cloud, they just want results. It's about how do you deliver the results to the executive and the team. And from a technology point of view, if it's not cloud first, mobile first, that's where all innovation is at the moment that I'm seeing out in the market. Everything cool, everything new, everything speedy is all being delivered cloud first and mobile first. So if you're not doing it, you're probably looking in the revision mirror as your business strategy rather than actually looking out through the front window. And I was lucky to work in a business that had a 5 and 10 year view, wanted to set itself up for sales, had a very clear business strategy. And part of that business strategy was getting the technology sorted to be able to sell the business. That's kind of why I joined Channel Club, so it's exciting for me. But it was the CEO driving that strategy, and he just wanted results.
Fair enough. Cloud was the way to deliver.
And cloud was our way to deliver that. We were hybrid cloud, like Gilbert showed, on pure cloud. Results.
Peter, you've probably been in the cloud for a lot longer than many organisations in this country. So tell us a little bit about what Flight Centre's done. Where did you get started and where are you now?
Yeah, we probably, just reflecting about 6 years ago, we sort of started down a bit of a Google path. And a lot of that driver for us was that, you know, the size of the organisation, the amount of information that we had, the amount of physical infrastructure we'd need to manage that just by email, it just wasn't sustainable for us. So we certainly went down that path. I suppose since then, you know, a similar strategy is what Phil's been talking about, is that, you know, our problem is scale and having to scale out quickly. Also the various demands of our business. So having to be a little bit more innovative and creative, but I think also more that traditional operating processes and the ability for those to grow and to then lock into a bit more of a commercially sort of scalable model. You can't continue to invest in infrastructure. It just doesn't scale anymore.
Okay. Maybe to our vendor partners then. I mean, does this sort of match up with the sort of the reasons why you're hearing your clients getting into the cloud? Steve, what are they telling you about why they want to get there?
Those same topics come up every time. Yeah, I think we're looking at a couple of success stories here. We've certainly had a number of customers that those same reasons or those drivers have actually been, they've had the opposite effect. So it's driven up costs. They've actually created less flexibility. And I think in some of those cases, they've been trapped or they haven't had choice. So there's a fair amount of detail. And I think the team could definitely share their experiences in going through that detail, because you need to know what you're getting into. And my personal belief is you also need to ensure that you've got choice moving forward. So we've certainly seen those two things backfire in some customer bases.
Right. So when an organisation is looking to go to the cloud, then what should they be assessing? What are the key components of the cloud provider that are the important things to be looking at? So I just saw you after that one.
Yeah,
sorry
about
you. Thank you, Brett. That's all right.
We've all bought stuff, right? So when you buy stuff, you want to know what you buy is what's written on the tin. You want to know when you get the tin that it's actually what you wanted. So all that's goodness. But equally, what you bought today, you're probably going to use it for 5 years, even if it's short-term. Short-term hangs around like a bad smell. So you've probably got it for 5 years. So you've probably got a choice with what you buy and what you use. So it's about understanding what the supplier's R&D strategy is, what their culture is. There's been a change in CEO, one of the major IT suppliers in the world, and hasn't that changed their culture and their cloud-first strategy? So it's actually trying to pick those technology trends and picking the right fit for you. I find as a customer trying to get that culture aligned between your service provider and you is one of the drivers of success, because if they understand you and believe in you, they won't let you fail.
Yeah.
Right, your story, right?
Absolutely.
I'll sell to you.
Sure.
And it's 100% right. Where we're seeing it successful is where the relationship goes. It actually brings some of the future consumption models, but brings the traditional relationships and partnering that you have. And those things can't be solid. You know, in my view, the partnering aspect is critical. And it comes back to all those things you talked about, Phil.
I might come back to that in a minute, because the relationship seems to come up a lot when the question of selecting the cloud provider comes on. But I often get told that I don't care what's in the cloud, I just want the cloud, and I just want it to work. What does that mean from your perspective? Should people actually care what the boxes are that these things are going to run on?
My obvious answer is yes.
And why would you say that?
Yes. Look, you know, let's be fair, I think that software is becoming more relevant in terms of managing workloads and sourcing workloads. So I think that, you know, it's changing, but some things aren't changing. And our job as a vendor is to deliver your hardware that ultimately drives the outcomes, and sometimes, most of the time, that outcome is reducing your cost base. So, you know, when you look at hardware, there's a couple of different thoughts, different trains of thought, I guess, out there. You know, we focus very much on reliability. That's key for us. And reliability, really, for you guys or for Interactive, equals cost. It equals maintenance. It equals downtime. It equals the ability to manage that. That drives up costs for cloud, regardless of whether it's, you know, private or public. If I look at conversion, hyperconverged, you know, there's the ability for us to go and build very sustainable systems. Their security is very important within those infrastructures. So as we look at security and our impact on how we manage security, we have TPM in all of our platforms. TPM is a trusted platform merger that verifies the firmware, and you know, you don't get the exposure to malware attacks that you might get with a non-platform like that. I'd say, as you look at things like the hyperconverged systems, you know, there's a lot of white box out there as well. So, you know, as a tier one vendor, we look at the Googles of the world and to some extent the other large sort of cloud providers, and they're very focused on cost, but you need a big infrastructure to go service that. And I think as a vendor for cloud, we're focused on taking those costs back out of the business for the provision of that outcome.
So we heard from them, we saw in the slides that a lot of organisations haven't gone to cloud yet, so they're clearly still working their way through the development strategy. John, from your perspective, in terms of what your clients are telling you, when do you think is the right time for an organisation to start making that move?
Good question. There's plenty of use cases, right? End-of-life hardware, end-of-life software, major software currency upgrades that need to happen. Inability to innovate, starting to choke on kind of keeping the lights on. We've definitely seen plenty of cases where IT teams, internal IT teams, are choking on operations. And it's definitely an interesting time when architects and VAs and designers are spending most of their time trying to keep the lights on and not innovating. And that's definitely you know, a conversation we'd like to have with our customers. You know, we certainly espouse, you know, letting go of the run and allowing us to come in and you know, take them on the journey and allow them to then focus on innovating. So, you know, again, I'm going to use the relationship word. You know, at that point in time, you've really got to decide, you know, is cloud a transaction or is it a relationship? And reality is what we think is it's a relationship, and leveraging the benefits of cloud is all about picking the right partner and making sure you invest in a relationship that you think you can live with. It's not just about that. Technology, even though I know it's very important to you, it's oscillating around that technology and how your partners do that. So
the partnership is so important, because what you're doing is you're removing the what from the equation. You're trusting these guys with the what, and you're focusing. Sorry, you're removing the how and focusing on the what. So it gives you the ability to go into a problem that you have in the business and really focus on the outcome, not how you're going to deliver the outcome and the infrastructure around the outcome. And that, you know, that partnership becomes paramount to that.
All right, so if it's a marriage rather than a one-night stand, who do you determine who you're getting married to? Theo, what was your thought process in selecting a vendor?
Yeah, I think it's important that you find a partner that is similar to your thought processes in terms of where you want to go. And the strategy is aligned in terms of the relationship side, the development, the innovation, and the attitude to delivering what you want for your end users. And I think it's also very important that you look at individuals who have started from the ground up as well. So they've had a look at the business, they've looked at it in terms of maturing it, they've had a good grounding from where they've been, and they can see where they want to go in the future as well. And lining up those two strategies allows you to then have longevity in the relationship, to understand that you're both at the same size, you're both looking for accelerated growth, you're looking for quality in the relationship, so that you're not stranded when you're struggling with certain pieces of technology or how to deal with it, and to have the architecture made available to you through that thought process allows you to then also think about what the business strategy is going to be to deliver that growth over the 5 to 10 year period.
Right, well, if you continue the relationship theme for a moment, I mean, most people are pretty good on the first day. So how do you look past that? How do you actually understand from the get-go
what it is that you're actually going into a relationship with, because you don't have forever to make these decisions. Well, what was the process for you? How do you go about assessing who that partner is going to be and whether they're the one for you?
I think it depends on the size and scale as well, right? And sometimes it's a boutique startup, you just go meet all the founders, that's easy, all the way through to the big players. Even the big players have a lot of local presence and do rely on relationships, so they're not purely transactional. And it's really getting to understand them. I mean, I ask for what's their R&D strategy, what's their product roadmap, what's their historical spend, what's their future spend, how they delivered on their historical spend, and ask the executive team to meet for big ones, not small ones, and actually understand if they'll get on and do business together. That's the way I go about it, so I'm suggesting that's the only way.
Well, Peter, you've been in a few relationships now. Actually, you're in a couple simultaneously. What have you learned along the way then? What do you do differently now that you weren't doing 3 or even 6 years ago when you first started down this path?
Definitely, I think in terms of that relationship you have is you're standing in that greater business, so you can deal with some big players in the space, and you're not necessarily going to get much cut through in terms of the standard service, the standard offering. You've been quite careful in that. You probably see that as almost a very commoditized type relationship where you probably turn that around and say it's just about price and performance at that stage. I think from a strategic relationship, as we would call it, and we do rate our partners differently. You probably need to look at other tenants like the agility of the organisation, flexibility, the ability to connect us to other like-minded individuals, just offering some other options in the community. Importantly, to challenge us, I would say as well. We're not always going to know the right thing. Everyone thinks they know everything, and they're always right. But it's always nice to be challenged, to be told you're wrong. And also from a cultural perspective, you don't expect your partner to be part of your culture. Goodness knows, we've done it for a kill of you people to get that. But at least an appreciation for our culture, as some of our partners would know, and how we work, and willing to work with in those sort of those aspects.
What responsibility falls back on the service provider? And John, thinking about it from your perspective, it's probably possible to say yes to every client that comes to you, but I can imagine doing that is going to lead to some of the scenarios that we've talked about here. So, from an interactive perspective, what do you say no to when a client comes to you?
I guess the first thing is to really understand where cloud can and can't help in a customer situation, and that really does take pretty broad and deep understanding of both the technology and the services available in cloud. And from there, it's using that expertise to assess workloads, etc. There's still plenty of technologies out there. I looked at some of those pie charts. There's plenty of technologies out there, plenty of applications that are written for mainframes and AS400 and older technology that still exists and still holds up, plenty of the banks and plenty of the miners, etc. So it's really understanding what can and can't move and whether you can actually have a successful migration and move into the cloud and ensuring that the customer gets the same throughput, the same performance, etc. As I said, other workloads on mainframe and AS400, you really look at that and really try not to attempt that. I think that you're going to make a fool of yourself.
Actually, I don't think I've seen anyone put AS400 in the cloud yet, but hey, you can get an opportunity out there.
There
you go.
Well, Matt, he's got a good point. I think, for us, the customers, I talk about the customers here, that we work best with are the customers the most open with us. Because ultimately for us, success is success for our customers. And John makes a good point. We understand the technology really, really well and how to implement. We've implemented it well for a range of customers. But I think if the onus goes back on the people in this room to a large extent to understand the business outcomes you actually want to drive. And if you can share that with us, then we can roadmap that. And I had a customer, I was speaking to a customer last week, and the problem actually wasn't the cloud. The problem was the endpoint devices, the managed devices they had in their sales team. So it's looking at the implementation of the CRM or whatever it's going to be, but then looking a bit further past that and really having that sort of end-to-end ownership. So I think we can definitely do, Lenovo, we can hopefully do most of the hardware journey, but I think you have to have a more holistic view of actually the outcomes you're trying to drive, and then we can really start to enable those much more confidently.
I might just add, Brad, I think it's also important, this is something Steve and I have spoken about a lot, data, and data, you know, data having gravity, and the weight of data, and sometimes those things are actually quite difficult to move. And so, you know, speed and access and where you put that data needs to come into the mix. So not just the technology, but the data, or what you do with the data, how you want to serve that data up. And if it's high upload, you know, high upload, high download type data, and you really, really want to think about exactly, you know, where you put that data. That's important to your end users.
Steve, isn't that why you're going down the software-defined world to try and to make that world easier?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, software-defined gets thrown out there a lot. And you know, what you're talking about is abstracting, you know, the software from the hardware layer, but we, you know, we think it goes further than that. And, you know, I'll come back to the detail earlier on. Almost every environment you go into today, especially in the large public areas, they're a one-way ticket. And that's not soft, you know, that in our mind, we have this mantra within our organization. We want to make it as easy to get off our platforms as it is to get on our platforms. And if we do that and we can scale that outside of even the great environment that we build with Interactive, a number of things happen. First, if it's that easy for you to get off our platforms onto one of these others, we have to stand by our service. And secondly, what both the guys were saying, if your strategy has something that doesn't fit with what we're doing, then we want to enable you to move that data out. And again, you know, I joked the last time I had I was with Professor Lindsay Bottom, and I said, you know, how long does it take to move 2 petabytes of data? Not knowing who I was talking to, and he gave me an answer. Never expected it, but it takes a long time. So you've got to take data management into your thinking, and you've got to have those open conversations with your customers, saying where you want to go, how do you want to do it, and you've also got to trust that organisations like ourselves and Interactive are open to saying not all of this is going to sit on us, and that's why we firmly believe in software defined, but not software defined that just lives in our ecosystem. And I think one of the challenges that you will have is almost every major provider out there is building an ecosystem and helping you get in there and not helping you get out, and you need that choice.
I imagine this is pretty fundamental. I mean, Peter, obviously, if your cloud and systems go down, flight centers off the air, Theo, I imagine it would be, you know, even worse for you, though, because you've got 50 equity partners that pretty much rely on you to run.
Yeah, and that's the important thing about it, is that the reliability needs to be there. They're income-generating businesses, and if for every minute that they're off the air or not online, that's income lost. So it's very important to establish that relationship with a supplier or a vendor who you can trust, and that the reliability is there for your businesses, because that is the next step for them to consider their strategic imperatives in terms of what they want to do in the marketplace. It allows them to be lower cost vehicles to enter into areas that they may never have reached if the reliability isn't there from the technology point of view. So it's important to have that reliability. It's important also to have the scalability of both vertically and horizontally scaling your business. And to do that, you need a partner who's going to be doing the R&D for you, who's going to challenge you, like a lot of the panelists have said here. And it's also being able to throw out those ideas, being open to say, I'm thinking about doing this, but I have no roadmap in terms of how I want to get there at the moment. So what do I need for me to take the right steps and to take it to the board to say the investment over the next 3 years to get there is going to be step one, step two, and step three. Because that's a lot of things that sort of dissipates in the conversations. Lots of boards sit there going, technology is in a black box. You're just going to get me to spend more money. So you need to be able to put the business case forward, and surprisingly you see it on the slide that the business case is the most important element of trying to get success out of it. And to strengthen that with the strategy and the research that's coming out of the area makes it a lot easier. So you can show what the profitability element's going to be over the next 3 years. So yeah, it's very important.
So I might just throw one more question up and then we'll go to the floor. So if we've got our two roving mics at the ready. So Thor, question for you then. So we talk about the idea of cloud as being transformed into all these wonderful new things in your business. So do you select a cloud provider that meets your strategy, or do you change your strategy in order to take advantage of the cloud? Which way does it work?
I've got two answers for you, Brad. One if you're a technology company and one if you're not.
Who are the technology companies here? Who are the ones who aren't? Right, that's your answer.
Okay, you're a technology company, you're not doing cloud first, the end is nigh. So
yeah,
move on. If you're not, it's got to be driven by my comment before about the CEO, the board, the executive team. They want results, what's your business strategy? That referred to openness, how much you're actually willing to share with your key partners. The more you share, the better outcome you get. I know personally, John, on my left here, if I want to do something stupid, he'll ring up. That's pretty way stupid, way, don't they? That's exactly the relationship you want, and it's a matter about building and fostering that relationship, as well as understanding the R&D and the culture. My answer.
All right, if no one's got anything to add to that, I'm going to go out to the floor and see what our assembled audience here. We've had a few drinks by now, so now you've got a couple of questions to loosen up. Steve Keenan in the front.
Hi, Stephen Keenan. As the only journalist here, I thought maybe I should be the one who breaks the ice and asks the first question. That's what I'm being paid to do. A few CIOs here on the panel who embraced public cloud. I think Flight Centre, I know we've reported on with Google, and I'm sure the rest of the guys have all gone down that line. And I promise I'm not a plant. This is not a free kick, but I'm really asking this question off my own bat. Where does Interactive fit in your mix? Considering that you are also using the public cloud, I'd just love to understand a bit more about what they do for you guys. It sounded like a free kick, I know. I promise you it was, I am really interested.
I think, it's quite funny in some of the comments that have been made around a good partner strategy and someone that can evolve and work with you. And our relationship started with Interactive probably about 12 years ago. And it was really just swapping out really old arcade hardware when I broke that, a warehouse full of old equipment. From there, it sort of evolved in data center space, and today we've just signed a contract. We're in direct to take over the management of our infrastructure environment, so we won't have an infrastructure team moving forward. So as we start to, other than technology, commoditize a lot of that in our world, that's what we're relying on our partners to take on. In that sense, as I say, having worked with, and being part of that relationship for 12 years, that's not something you want to throw away quickly. So you'll work really hard to maintain that. And just like we want our partners to challenge us, we'll challenge our partners as well to grow with us. Because I think the world's changing rapidly, and I think we've heard it before, that sometimes not everyone has the answers. So I think it's having a really good impact system, being able to push forward together, and I think that joint success with both parties is really important. So.
I think, you get the word co-opetition. It is getting more and more critical for, whether it be the small players or the large players. I talk about us breaking down. Our whole concept is companies like Flight Centre are going to have choice. They are going to work with multiple providers. And again, it's up to us to prove why our services and what we do. But then the responsibility is on ourselves and Interactive and, Lenovo on how do we integrate with those platforms? How do we integrate with, whether it be one of the hyperscalers that Peter's already talked about? And that's actively, we are driving a lot of R&D because it's not going to be one or the other. Just like they say, it's not, most people are going to have some kind of hybrid model.
Bill, did you want to jump on that?
Oh, I can't add much more. I've interacted with a number of organizations around the hardware sparing, dedicated hosting, private cloud. You guys don't do public cloud yet. I was pushing John to do the infrastructure outsourcing. Glad to hear that's happening.
We're a similar journey to Flight Centre. We've been in a 6 to 7 year relationship with Interactive, and it's been a positive one for us. And we're actually entertaining the same process that you're looking at the moment, and that is to outsource as much as we can into that framework, and that will free up a lot more work for us to concentrate on more business-driven activities than having to focus on hardware and focus on the management of those elements. That's not our ring butter. Our ring butter is to generate income through insurance premiums and the rest, and our focus needs to be on that, strengthened by a strong infrastructure
backbone. One other comment I'd make was, you used the Google reference, and today I was listening to actually Ricky runs Google Cloud across APAC, and the whole time he used the word managed services, he was calling his thing managed services. And the last time we had one of these, that's why Interact has been so successful, because if you think about their pedigree and what they've done, they have a strong services ethos and a strong services background. And that's what they're building. And to some extent, cloud is the next evolution of managed services. You know, and it's this whole hamster wheel, you know, that we're going in IT mainframe. You know, this is, there's a lot of similarities here. And I think it's the managed services background that Interactive has moving into these new alternative consumption models, which makes them a great partner to work with.
Since you gave me the free kick, I'm going to go with it.
Well, we did say this was not a sales event, so thanks,
I personally love customer stories. My team will tell you I love the technology as much as anybody, but the customer stories are the ones that really resonate with me. And you know, extending on these stories here, if I may, I'll share another interesting customer story. We had a retailer who was quite a large Australian retailer in the Australian market. What they decided to do, you know, like most retailers are suffering, you know, bricks and mortar retailers are suffering from the online onslaught. And so they decided to take a very different channel or pathway to their customers. And what they started to look at was, you know, digital content delivery, which is a completely different business model to just putting up their stuff online. And, you know, so they built a business case, they presented it to the board, and that business case wasn't just about cost. And it even went beyond relationships. We'll spend a lot of time on relationships. Their business case was all about speed to market and using the cloud to get to market, get their product to market more quickly. And it's a really interesting business case because I'm seeing more and more of that, which is using cloud to innovate. I think Phil and Steve mentioned using cloud to unleash their ability to innovate. And so what they did is they presented a hybrid cloud strategy. They had a public cloud provider in the mix. Had ourselves from a private cloud perspective, and what that then meant was they were no longer waiting on kit to arrive, no longer bound to long-term software contracts that didn't allow them to experiment with software out in the marketplace, and really, from a talent perspective, meant that they didn't have to then hunt for talent, integrate that talent when they found it into their business. They left all of that to their two major suppliers, and what they were then able to do is release their offering much more quickly into the marketplace. You know, arguably, I know speaking to the CIO at the time, he was saying probably 12 months faster than they otherwise could have. That's a really different, you know, view on, you know, unleashing innovation and really avoiding the lag behind competitors and potentially losing that first mover advantage that you might have in any of the offerings or products that you might be thinking about releasing. So it's a different view.
Very much back to that flexibility point that came up in the slide there before. We had another question about another journalist. There were two in the room and they both put their hands up. Alex, go ahead.
And I'll just wait for
the non-journalist.
We're sure.
Go for it.
I'll just wait for the microphone. Oops. I just thought, I would remind everyone there is more than one journalist in the room, and I'm actually recording it tonight. If you want to see this event again tomorrow, you can go to itwire.com and the whole event will be available for your disposal. But I thought I'd ask John Hannah, how long does it take to copy 2 petabytes? He left us hanging there. And then secondly, can any of you share, or whoever it was that mentioned it, but can any of you share some of the trials and tribulations in securing the cloud? I mean, we take security for granted. It's going to be secure until it's not, and it's splashed all over the papers, and Australia doesn't have mandatory disclosure laws on that thing anyway. So what are some of the things you might want to tell us about the, you know, making sure that everything is secure, you do all the penetration testing, you pay white hat hackers to keep your customers' data super safe? Thank you.
Who wants to tackle that one?
I think Steve should tell us how fast it was to copy 2 petabytes.
The high performance compute environment that these guys have, which is designed just to throw data at you know, very quickly, and how they're moving data from the US locally, it was 2 weeks.
But
if you think about, and that's 2 weeks in a custom build, you know, like that's the, I don't know, the fastest thing on the planet that's designed for that. If you think about it in a business context, when that's your, you know, your application data and everything else, you're looking at, you know, if you're pretty good, it's gonna take months and months and months. So, but they could do 2 weeks and I'll never ask them that question again.
And then the security. And then the security side of things.
Yeah, who wants to tackle the security question?
Well, I'll give it a quick go. I think in security, some of the, I suppose you'd call it more public cloud, some of the offerings in there are actually quite good these days. And you know, they do know that's big reputation stuff, so they do really have to be secure.
Are security costs rising or falling?
Definitely rising at the moment, and certainly for an organisation like us, it's quite large. You know, a big push now for us over the next few years is how do we start to really push the cost of that compliance and security down? It's a similar story. You need to keep moving up the stack, so to speak, with security. Security's very much like what IT operations was about 5-10 years ago. It's a bit of a mess. I think there's a big opportunity coming for organisations to start sort of offering more as a service type options there, which sort of makes it more cost effective.
Any other comments on the security one? I'm sure you've got your own. John, go on.
No, sorry, I've
got a question.
All right.
Hang on, who's got the mic? We'll go with Mike.
Thank you. In terms of lessons learned, I mean, obviously there's a lot of people out here who have not gone to the cloud, but I'm thinking, this is aimed at people who are in the cloud. If you could jump in the DeLorean back in the future, travel back in time, and deliver the biggest lessons you've learned along the way, what would you say to yourself?
If you could do it all again, what would you do differently?
I've done it perfectly.
I'm talking
about a customer that's not on stage right now. There's two things. It's planning and stakeholder management. I think stakeholder management is absolutely key. So when you go and deploy scenarios, you need to be engaging the HR team and the marketing team and the sales team to make sure what you need to deploy. Otherwise you have to backtrack and unplug and, you know, go again. So I think planning is probably one of the most important things you need to do, and you need to get the people that are actually going to use it involved.
I might answer that in our world. Just reflecting on it, actually, to be honest, we probably should have done it a lot sooner. In our world, you know, we have a lot of demand for things. That shadow IT is out there, and if you look around, I think globally, one of the phenomena is that shadow IT is being handed back to IT now to make sense of it. And you know, those ideas that were great at the time with one function no longer offer that value. So you're going to have to combine it with other things. So certainly IT inherits this bit of a mess. Yet again, dragging people out into those areas and not actually innovating and offering more service. So I think in our case, technology probably should have stepped up a lot sooner in terms of that, the way in which they delivered solutions.
I think I might add to it, you know, you'd all be surprised, but I actually run our IT systems also at Interactive, and so I kind of have to eat our own dog food, and you'd be also surprised that not everything at Interactive is actually running on the Interactive cloud. And so one of the approaches we took a cloud first, package first approach internally, and when you look at, you know, software like Salesforce.com, great CRM, you know, it's for us it was also considering best of breed. Just trying to find best of breed and utilising best of breed for our end users. And so that's a big lesson that we've learned is look for best of breed.
Okay, another question out there. There's one at the back. You got any other hands up just while I'm looking around? There's another one at the front. So yeah, if we can get the microphone to that gentleman. Almost there. And I'll go over Alex. Great, we'll take you and then to the chat behind you afterwards.
Thanks for that, great discussion. I'm Ian Chilton from the Port Authority of New South Wales. As somebody who's looking on embarking on this journey, I'm quite interested to know what the impact on your IT staff were. So we talk about them becoming, you know, less technicians and more brokers of services and managers of partnerships. What's the story there? How did that work?
For us, it is a cultural change for a lot of our technology guys. Concept that their job element has changed a little bit in terms of having to actually touch the kid, manage the kid, look after the kid. It's now moved into a new role where it's a little bit more of a challenge for them in terms of identifying and understanding the business elements behind it. So I think you spoke about it earlier around vendor management. So now the mindset's around how do I work with the vendors and what am I going to get with that relationship and how am I going to build on that relationship, so that I can return all that good stuff back into the business. And for the investment that's been in there, as spoke before, what is the return on my investment? So that's a little bit more of a change now. It's not only just thinking about the technology, but also putting a business hat back on now and looking at what would that mean to me if I was to go out and spend X dollars on certain technology, whether it's hardware, whether it's software, whatever it is. And that's a little bit of a mindset change for some of our guys, but they've embraced it. And I think it's important as CIOs or leadership teams to explain that to them, that their role is changed a little bit, but it's also going to still benefit the business in the long run. And as long as you can explain that to them, they're pretty good, they're not too bad.
I'd answer that one as well. I think, same here, and I think that the prospect of being involved in something that perhaps is a little bit more becoming mainstream, I think this, moving to this sort of two-speed way of delivering IT services around operations and then innovation is going to fast become market standard. So if you're working for an IT function, it's now about being able to work effectively in that environment, not necessarily what you used to be doing. Having said that, not everyone's going to come on the journey. And in our case, where we talked earlier about the interactive agreement that we have, we'll be taking some of our staff, interactive will be taking some of those people on. And they want to deal with the technology at that level. So it's not like we're trying to force them to do something they don't want to do. At least I hope they are. Exactly. Are you telling Chris something? I'm going to have a chat after this. But certainly that opportunity there is to move through with our partners to offer sort of options for our people as well.
Okay, so there's another question. Please go ahead.
Greg Porter is my name. I'm the CIO at the Royal Australasian College of Physicians. Interesting to hear Lindsay Bottom's name up. I worked with him for about 8 years when I was IT director at UTS. Actually, he was trying to set up a visualization lab and we were trying to justify a supercomputer for the university. But that's another story. But he's a very interesting fella. We've already spoken, I guess, about the fact that cloud isn't everything, and it's not a question of whether cloud or not. There are many other options for us running our businesses these days, and I guess if you look at the whole gamut of them, it's sort of cloud, it's hybrid cloud, software as a service, and I know we're entering into a business process as a service. I guess I'd like to know what your experience is in running your organisations across those range of services and how you integrate across those. And again, the security issue, because that becomes, I think, exponentially higher in that sort of environment. But that's certainly the environment we'll be looking at and going into.
So I'm happy to give that a first shot. We talked before about the business drivers, the CEO's want results, that leads to a business strategy and a technology strategy, and hopefully they're connected. What then leads to that is your enterprise architecture and your data architecture. And that slide we had before about who's driving the move to the cloud, you've got to solve the data architecture as technology professionals. Most of us spent the last 20 years consolidating, standardizing, actually understanding what we have, and we run the risk of it exploding out the other way if we don't understand the data architecture, and wrapped around that is security. There's some high profile stuff in the paper at the moment about that. But it's really grabbing hold of all of that architecture and understanding it. And then you can connect stuff in and out and you get the agility and flexibility.
Again, that's where we point a ton of our R&D is doing exactly that. You know, we've got organizations that are APRA regulated, there's no way they can go in there. We are enabling them to do that. You know, they can absolutely embrace cloud and have that same data management. You know, again, if I look at some of the quotes I've heard today in the earlier session, your data is becoming probably one of your most important currencies in your business.
We've got a couple more questions out there. I think we've got one on this side of the room, so go ahead, please.
Andrew Hillman from Commonwealth. Not a question, but just a bit of a response to the security question that was raised before. I've been in the data protection information management field for about 20 years, and I get that question fairly frequently. And one of the things I look at is, especially up in the cloud, is there are things as encryption and there's auditing. A couple of questions that I usually ask senior execs that are typically the people that are in the room today. Look in your own office. how much paperwork do you leave in your desk, how much is locked away in a private cabinet. So think about the types of applications and the information you want to put in the cloud. The other question I ask them is, how often do you use a courier and how often do you use a fax?
I might even extend on that with regards to security. I think, and it was a good question, I think we've obviously heard it a couple of times. I think it's incumbent obviously on the buyer to check the security credentials of the providers that you're talking to, be it a software as a service house, be it a cloud IaaS house. Absolutely check those credentials, and that's not just checking an ISO 27001 certification. Ask them, what is their security posture? What is their security regime? I heard somebody using pen testing before. You know, what penetration testing do you do? How regularly do you do it? Share with me your patching programs, etc. Absolutely ask for those things, and don't be shy about it. Expect and demand those things, and hopefully you'll get answers that either fill you with confidence or allow you to navigate through to another supplier.
Okay, we've probably got time for one more question, so if you'd like to. Gentlemen, right here.
Is there anyone else, just by the way?
Okay, go ahead, please.
Hi, Stephen Pryor from A1. One of the things that I've noticed is that the move to cloud seems to be reminiscent of the move to virtualization a few years back. And with the agility that comes with the cloud, I'm sure it's very easy for IT functions to lose control of TCO for IT services. So how do you maintain that governance with the rest of the business? How do you maintain the discipline?
That daily failure. I was laughing before when someone said about the relevance of IT. Someone needs to be blamed when it breaks. So I think that process of that broader business strategy, it's no longer an IT strategy, it's got to be a business strategy. And the IT is the enablement of that business strategy, and it's really important to get the most senior people on board with that. And that's the only way that I can say that you can control it. It doesn't always work. In our environment where, you know, we do have a lot of empowerment as part of our culture, people will always be out there. So that for us means that the IT function becomes more consultants and more moderators rather than, you know, roadblockers and governance that needs to be followed, because if you try and do that, people will work around it. So it's not about stopping, it's about steering, and I think that's really important. So first of all, having that business strategy and then being able to be more that moderator of that and that consulting rather than having to stop things from happening.
Yeah, and that's right. I think that the ability to work around it is easier today than it was 10 years ago. That's probably the hardest thing. And as long as you've got a governance process around it that engages the right bodies and the right stakeholders, then you're at least on the right path to managing that cost of operating in that environment. It's very, very easy for the group to go through a process where you've got some savvy people coming through now. They're very educated when it comes to technology. They've done their university degree. They know how to do certain things and work with certain technologies. The ability to get mobile is very easy for them. So it's just trying to embody all of those things that they're wanting in a consumer world and translating it back into a corporate world. So that's probably the biggest challenge for us as COOs, is to work with the consumer world but still offer it under the commercial and corporate world. So they will always find a way to get around that frame.
I think it's that sort of empower of the business. You're really on the front foot, actually
pushing
the business.
It, that's right.
And when you're pushing the business, you're a little bit more in control and of destiny, rather than, you know, being that fifth meeting and not knowing what the hell's going on. You've got to be at the table, actually making the business think and challenging.
Hey, you've got to recognise too. IBM do that survey every year. They survey the top 1,000 CEOs, right? And again this year, for the third year in a row, technology is the number one transformational tool they're going to run the business. Like, they already know that. They don't know how necessarily. They don't know how they're going to implement the strategy to get there. So that's, you know, something from the front foot is your, what you call it, your best defense, but you need to understand the business. That'll get you there.
All right. think on that note, we've probably extracted as much from our panel as we can before we get him another drink. So I think it's time that we did that. And to officially close up, though, I'm going to invite Chris back up on stage to
Everybody, please, a round of applause for these. I'll sum up very briefly. There's clearly no substitute for experience in this transformational world that we're in. And when I listen to you guys talk, you give me immense confidence that for your businesses, that what you do really is, it's actually quite awe-inspiring, because in IT, really, there's only focus and the spotlight goes on us when there's a problem. And then the heat's on and the pressure's up, and when to see you guys talk and strategize about what you're doing. My sincere thanks to all of you. We've got some gifts, and you'll go through with Theo and Matt and Peter and John and Phil and Steve. Thank you, gentlemen, and Brad. You're a moderator who knows what he's talking about, and they're rare. So thank you very much. Now, lastly, to Lenovo and NetApp, we can't thank them enough, because in the end, they're at the core of the DNA of what we provide. Thank you, gentlemen. It has been absolutely tremendous. Please join us outside for some drinks. Let's get to know each other, and we really appreciate you coming and being part of this night tonight. And it is about a bridge to getting you to where you want to go. That's why we call it the Bridge Series. When you go home, you'll think to yourself, geez, that's so savvy, a bridge to where I want to go. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.